Okay. So this is about spontaneity. Coping. So basic coping means the things what you should do is listen, try to accommodate, explain, let go of the customer. And something what you should not do is take customer's dissatisfaction personally. Just because a customer has told you something, he's telling you on behalf of the company because you are the point of contact between you and the company, between the customer and you. So he's the only one who is going to tell you. So you don't have to take anything what customer says about a about yourself or your company personally, because he's saying on behalf of his need what the things have not been done. He's saying for the company. So and same way, let customer dissatisfaction affect others. You should not, you know, just make a mockery out of it. So you should ensure the customer is satisfied. So as the things what we covered, so again, common themes in critical service encounters: recovery, where employee responds to service delivery system failure; adaptability, employer response to customer needs and requests; coping, employer response to problem customers; spontaneity, unprompted, unsolicited employee actions and attitudes. So recovery means service deliver, how you're going to convince the customer, how you're going to solve the problem; adaptability, how much you're going to go up to to fulfill the customer needs. Are you adopting yourself? Is your response adapting to the customer needs or just a standard format? It may be possible that you're trying your best, but it is not what the customer wants. So probably you have to adapt to his situation. Coping, how much you're going to, you know, cope with the issue that are you going to take it personally what customer says, or are you going to trying to solve the problem? And spontaneity, maybe you have to look at things, some things which are unprompted, employee doesn't say, the customer doesn't say, but you look for it. So same thing, recovery. As I just mentioned, acknowledge problem, explain causes, apologize, compensate, lay out options, take responsibility. What you don't do is ignore the customer, blame the customer, and other things. Adaptability, recognize this seriousness of the need, right? Acknowledge, anticipate, attempt to accommodate, whatever it is there. So you acknowledge the problem, right? Take responsibility. But what you don't do is, you don't ignore him. You don't embarrass the customer. You should not be unwilling to help. Spontaneity, taking time to be attentive, anticipate needs, listen to him, right? Treat customers fairly, show empathy that you understand. What would you do if you were in his shoes? You know, don't, what you don't do is exhibit impatience, ignore the customer. You know, you don't, discriminate between high paying and low paying customer, probably because a high paying customer today is a low paying customer just because he's not buying more of your products. It does not mean he may not buy in future. It could be he's using a competitor's products, or it could be that he finds your service not up to the mark, probably because of various reasons. Price could be one, service quality could be one, which we'll discuss further. Coping. So, you know, you try to listen, accommodate, explain. Then, what you don't do is don't take customer dissatisfaction personally, because you're the point of contact between the company and yourself. So whatever you say, to the customer, this is what happens. So whatever you say to the customer, what if the customer says to you, it's because you're the point of contact between the customer and yourself, between the company and customer. So since you're the point of contact, you're the touch point, therefore it is understandable, the customer is blaming, talking to you, he's putting the blame on you because you're representative of the company. So you should not take it personally. Okay, evidence of service from the customer's point of view. Operational flow of activities, some of the things like operational flow of activities, steps in process. So these are the, as we discussed about, there are 7 P's in service marketing, right? instead of the four P's, the three P's which are extra compared to the physical products are the process, people, and physical evidence. So how they are in, they are all three interrelated. If you see, it is the process, the operational flow of activities, steps in a process, flexibility versus standard, technology versus human. These are the things you have to understand. These are the various evidence of service from the customer's point of view, right? The people, how does he see the service thing from him with respect to people? Contact employees, customer himself, other customers. Physical evidence, he sees tangible communication, right, which can come in the form of brochure and come from visiting card, right? The service scape, the physical buildings or the ambience of your office and other things, right? The guarantees given by you and the technology given. So these are physical evidence. Now we'll come to the relationship marketing. What is relationship marketing? It's a philosophy of doing business that focuses on keeping and improving current customers. You have to understand that, as we all know, it is easier and cheaper to maintain or retain existing customer than to take new customers on board. It has been said it is 5 times cheaper. So a company which does not have a good relationship with existing customers, it has to spend 5 times more to keep the same number of customers, because it has to keep on looking in the market to get more customers, right? So it is a better strategy to retain the existing customers first. One of the thing is that your costs are low, you know, you don't have to advertise so much. You have already won their their satisfaction, you have won their loyalty. So customers tend to go with you rather than taking, and you have already cut the competition. But if you're taking a new customer on board who is from another company, it's a struggle, because you have to break his loyalty from the previous company and get it onto you. So that's the problem with this. So therefore, it is easier to keep the same customers with you. It's cheaper and it makes sense. Therefore, you need to have proper relationship marketing. So it does not so it is cheaper, as this is what it says. When you have a good relationship marketing, they themselves, the existing customers, become the brand ambassadors, and over a period of time your customer base increases. So therefore, you should have a focus on attraction, retention, and enhancement of customer relationships. So what are the benefits of organization of customer loyalty? Loyal customers tend to spend more with the organization over time. Yes, because the same customers are they buying again and again, so repeat customers. The average cost of relationship maintenance are lower than new customer costs. Yes, as I discussed earlier, it's cheaper to maintain existing customers than get new customers. So retention is better. Employee retention is more likely with a stable customer base, because if you have a stable customer base, employees will also be happy, because they don't have to struggle so much to keep on getting new customers. Lifetime value of a customer can be very high. Yes, lifetime value is the accrued cost of a customer over a period of his life, right? Of a period of his life, that how much benefit he gives to the customer monetarily. So if a customer buys, you know, if you're making children's shoes, and we consider up to age of 16 their children, so we can see if a child starts buying his first shoe at the age of 2, then we have to see in the next, from his second year to 16 years, on an average of your customer profile, what is the customer is spending on between those in those 14 years. So the average spend is every year is about 1,000. So you can assume they have spent probably 14,000. So 1,000 base, if you have 1,000 customers, so 14,000 into 1,000. That's the that's the lifetime value of the combined customer base. For each customer, it is 14,000. So if the customer base, customer retention is good, then the value will be higher, because your base is going to be higher and he is more likely to buy from you again and again. And what are the benefits to the customer of retention? Benefits are good. He gets a good value because a retained customer is more likely to get better discounts. It's economic, social, and continuity benefits. So in contribution to the sense of well-being and quality of life, avoidance of change, he doesn't want to change again and again, he's happy. His decision making is simplified, so he's happy with that. He gets social support and friendships from the, you know, in the terms of brand ambassador, he talks to others, plus he gets from employees some sort of support. He gets special deals and deals and discounts. So how do you build strategies, you know, for building relationships? So foundations, excellent quality, one strategy is foundations. You have excellent quality against the value. So you give the highest quality in the minimum cost, so the customer sees the value in it. You have a careful segmentation. You divide the entire population. You divide the entire population of your customer into various segments and accordingly prepare different products and services as per the customer needs, so that they can find a higher value in terms of the quality they receive. Bonding strategies. The next is the bonding strategies. So you have financial bonds, means how you help them to bond between you, between the company and yourself through financial, this thing that could be priced, that could be discounts and other things. Social and psychological bonds. You use various social strategies to, you know, so that they become with you, so that you can create. So an example is you can create a social club for them. You can create a something, you know, a club. You can create an online chat group, a blog, whereby the customers, only your customers have access to it. And there it can be, you know, the like-minded people and your different customers of your company can interact with each other. So it becomes a social community. Then structural bonds and customization bonds. So you customize. Customization bonds means you customize the services according to the customer needs, and so he'll be happy. So relationships strategies wheel, and you have a relationships strategies wheel. We'll see that how, you know, different strategies are used in different customer types, in different stages of the customer. So if the customer, you know, there are different stages of relationships, and in each different stages of relationships, you have different strategies. So underlying logic of customer retention, what are the benefits of the to the organization? If you see over here on the below, on the above, it's the customer satisfaction. So if you see over here, quality service, if you give quality service, then customer is satisfied. If customer is satisfied, then customer definitely retention, customer retention increases. When customer retention increases, so your profits go up because the cost of maintaining a customer base is cheaper. When that happens, employee becomes more loyal, is more likely to be loyal because he finds there is more fun in working in the company, and he can focus on retention than on instead of creating an enlarged customer base again and again. And then you also have, you know, if they are loyal, employees are loyal, definitely they'll be very happy. And on their own, they will ensure that the customer service is of good quality, and the whatever recovery, if customer failure is minimized, and if there is a failure, customer failure, then it will be recovered very easily. Steps in market segmentation and targeting for services. So as we all know, you know, you have a huge population and different customers buy the same products for different reasons. So you have to segment the market and then see what are the various segments you need to target. First is the step one is identify basis for segmenting the market. Second is you first see what are the basis on which the segmenting market is done. It's it can be geographic, demographic, psychological, psychographic and behavioral, right? There are different ways by which you can do it. Then step two, develop profiles for resulting segments. You have to create a profile for each segment once you have segmented. Then you measure the segment attractiveness. You have to find how attractive the segment will be for for that particular group of customers for which you have put them in. Fourth is target, select the target segments where you want to target, because instead of a population, you have divided into five, and out of which probably you'll see three are more likely to be satisfied by you. So you target only the three segments instead of the five. Ensure that segments are compatible. And you have to ensure whether the segments are compatible to each other. So these are the levels of retention strategies, or it's the wheel of customer retention strategies, as we talked about earlier. So relationship strategies wheel, as talked about. So this is there, right? Relationship strategies wheel. So you have this, in the middle you have excellent quality and value. Then you have four financial bonds, social bonds, customization bonds, and structural bonds. So if you see in the financial bonds, it's the volume and frequency rewards, what you give it to them. It's second thing is stable pricing. Your pricing is stable. Then the bundling and cross-selling. Bundling means, like you have this buy or, you along with your product, you give something else. Like for example, if you join our join an MBA course in a particular college, you get a free laptop. That's called bundling. Cross-selling is if you've done an MBA over here, then we'll give you a better deal if you do our PhD also over here. Or if you have done a BBA over here, we give you a better deal in terms of pricing and other benefits if you join for an MBA. So that is called cross-selling. And cross-selling, it could be also be one is this. Other thing could be that, we have other courses where you can join, or it could be the same courses for your friends. So that's cross-selling. So if you see, all these three things are related to pricing. It's all related to finance. So therefore, it is called financial bonds. Then the social bonds, the continuous relationships you have, personal relationships you have with the employee and the customer, right? And social bonds among customers. So this is through, as I told you earlier, through some blogs, through some, community, through some club you make only for your customers where they can interact, one customer can interact with other customers. So these are social bonds. Customization bonds, right? So here your customer intimacy, how intimate you are with the customer in terms of, you understand his needs and fulfill his needs rightly. Then mass customization. Are you able to customize the, customize the product for the customer in a big way so that he's very happy? Because for most customers, even within segmentation, there'll be sub segments. So if you can still make products for them. Then anticipation innovation. Here you anticipate, you even before the customer tells you through some research study, you start thinking whether this could be a problem. This could be a better thing if you do it for customer. So you innovate accordingly and then give it to the customers. So these all are the various strategies which are the customization bonding strategies. Then you have the structural bonds. Fourth, shared processes and equipment, right? So how many shared process and equipment you can have within various services, the customer will be happy. Joint investments, jointly if you're investing. Integrated information systems, one place becomes a single window system where customers can get various information, right? So all these various strategies are divided into four different types of strategies: financial, social, customization, and structural. So altogether, these are various strategies, and in each these all clubbed into four different types: financial, social, customization, and structural bonds. So these are the wheel of retention strategies, and therefore the level of retention strategies. So service recovery. Okay, so in just see this chart and you know, you can see that it says unhappy customers. It's just a figure about, you know, the people when they're unhappy and repurchase intentions. So unhappy customers, if you see it, unhappy customers who don't complain are just 9%. Unhappy customers who do complain are 37%. Complaints not resolved 19%, right? So if you see, major complaints is in white and minor complaints is in blue. So all these blue. So minor one is in fact more. Complaints quickly resolved 95%, and the major ones are 82%. So major percentage of customers will buy again. So if it depends, if your major complaints are resolved quickly, then it is more likely that you are only 82% customers will buy. But if minor resolved, then customers are more likely to buy. The reason for that is, if a major complaint has happened, it means it's a major issue with the company who is not able to solve or effectively put forward a good quality service in the first place. So the major complaint should not come in the first place. Minor customer understands. So therefore, you know, the quantum of percentage of customers will buy again after the customer service has been resolved in a major one is less than the minor one. So customer response following service failure, right? How customer response following service failure happens? You can just have a look. So service failure, one, you take action, other one is do nothing. When you do nothing, what the customer does, he switch providers or stay with the same existing. So either he goes to another company or stays with the same one. These two things happen. If you take action, then, right? So service, you know, if the customer takes an action, he can complain to the provider or complain to family and friends or complain to third party. Now, ideally, you want your every customer should complain to you, but many times he does not do it. So he becomes a brand ambassador of negative customer feedback to the other customers in the society, potential customers. So probably you're not only having a bad impact on your existing customer base, but also on those who probably are not buying or the others who had a good service, right? So this is a danger over here. And then even then he might switch the providers or stay with it. So ideally, if you're there, if he complains, so you should take the, you know, solve the problem for him. Because if you solve the problem, he's more likely to stay with you. If not, he may go with others. Now, you may also say that even if you don't do anything, he may not stay with you. That if you don't do anything, he may still stay with you. But here the proportion is less. Here it could be because of pricing. Because if you see, like in Jio Mobile these days, the call is an issue, but data is not a problem. So what the people are still sticking with Jio because it has offered a very discounted cheap rate as of now. So as the rates increase, then the real test of Jio will come, how much customers are satisfied with them. Because at cheap rates, no one would like to switch. So they are there with them only for the timing, as long as the pricing is cheap. So therefore they are there. So the price is over here. Otherwise they would have switched to another ones. So service recovery strategies, various strategies, right? So what you have is, you know, fail safe the service. First of all, you ensure the service is fail safe. It does not have any, failure. And even if it has, you welcome and encourage complaints. So you have a feedback box, you have a helpline number, you have a toll-free number. You welcome and encourage customers. If you have the issue, they can contact. Then you ask, and when a customer complains, you should act very quickly. Then you should treat customers fairly, not that it should be based on your judgment, but you should treat them fairly. You should understand their point of view. Learn from the recovery experience. After you've treated them fairly, you should learn from the recovery experience whether the experience the recovery you've done for the customer has been good or bad, whether it's fruitful, whether the customer is likely to come back to you or is going to leave you. You can see how many of customers satisfied with your recovery strategies, right? You should also learn that how many customers you have lost because you either you complain, either the customers have not complained or you have not done a proper recovery. So therefore they are in a, like a cycle. So this learn from lost customers goes over there and makes your service fail proof. So this is how it works. So causes behind service switching. What are the various causes behind service switching? So you can see over here, right, various reasons why the customers will switch the services. Pricing is definitely one factor. High price, price increase, unfair pricing, deceptive pricing. Deceptive pricing means pricing where you companies say it will be priced at this, but when you actually buy, there are other hidden costs which are not there, right? So and when you purchase, then you find the price has increased substantially or maybe 20-30-40% more, which you had not thought of, which the company has not given earlier. So that is called deceptive pricing. Inconvenience, it could be location and hours when you're open, right? It is waiting for an appointment or service, it becomes a difficult. Core service failure, your service mistakes has happened, billing errors, service catastrophe, service encounters failure. Service encounter means the point where the customer and the company deals through various touch points. What are touch points? Touch points are the various places where the interaction between company and employees happens. So a website is a place, a telephone call is a place, toll-free number is a place, an employee reception is a place, and a service center is a place, and at these various touch points the service encounters takes place. So when we say service encounters failures, means the service encounter has not fulfilled the needs of the customer at that point of time, therefore it is called service encounters failures. So it could be because the employees are uncaring, impolite, unresponsive, unknowledgeable, they don't have the knowledge and they don't care and they don't polite, they shout back to the customer and the customer shouts at them. Response to service failure, it could be negative response, no response, reluctant response. These are the various things which could be there. Competition, because probably customers found a better service. Ethical problems could be there, that the companies, that the customer finds that the company is cheating to them. They are, they have been given a bad deal. Involuntary switching, the customer has just moved or the provider has closed. That could also be there. And these are the various reasons when the customers switch their services. Service guarantees. So guarantee, as the Webster says, it's an assurance of the fulfillment of a condition. So you guarantee a customer that this, we are assuring you that whatever the service we are giving, it will fulfill certain criteria, right? Now we do guarantee and warranty. So guarantee means you are replacing the product or service. The warranty means you repair it. So services cannot be guaranteed because there's nothing to replace it, but it can be repaired. Why it cannot be guaranteed? The simple logic is services are intangible. Suppose a laptop. Laptop is a product which can be repaired, which can be, right, that is one, but it can also be replaced if a problem is there. So it is guaranteed. But in warranty, it is only repair, and guarantee means replacement. So service you have already taken. Suppose you have a haircut and the haircut was not good. So he cannot give you back a new haircut. He can correct that bad haircut for you by you sitting it again, and he'll make the corrections. So therefore it is warranty in service, right? The simple reason it says over here, cannot return the service. Service experience is intangible. So there's no point to guarantee. Effectiveness of an effective service guarantee. So first thing is how effective the service guarantee is or warranty is in this place. To find out how effective it is. One thing is there, unconditional. The guarantee should make it promise unconditionally. It should be that we'll try to solve the problem without any hitches or without any strings attached. Meaningful. It should guarantee elements of the service that are important to the customer. You know, you're trying to solve a problem for the customer, what the customer, for which the customer has bought your service in the first place. Not what you think is correct, but what the customer thinks is correct. That it should be meaningful from his point of view, not from your point of view. The payout should cover fully the customer's satisfaction. Whatever you're giving him in return, it should cover his dissatisfaction. It should be easy to understand and communicate for customers. They need to understand what to expect. For employees, they need to understand what to do. That is also there. You know, they should understand what should be expected from them, and employees should also understand that how they should care for it. Easy to invoke and collect. There should not be a lot of hoops. You know, it's very easy to, it should be easy to get that service guarantee done by the customer to the company. Whenever he comes with a faulty service, what the company has done, the customer should not have a big problem in requesting the company to solve the problem. Right? So he should be in a position to access that complaint, and he should be in a position to access that problem solving system or the service recovery condition, whatever the company has laid out. So why a good guarantee works? Because it forces company to focus on customers. Yes. Sets clear standards. If a good guarantee will work when the standards are clear, it generates feedback. It gives company to, makes the company understand why it failed. And it makes a marketing muscle. It makes your marketing stronger because you understand the customer better when the customer has, when you're giving a good guarantee to him. So you also have to make sure that you are fulfilling it. Services guarantees. Does everyone need a guarantee? Reasons companies do not offer guarantees. Guarantees would be at odds with company's image. Yes, many times companies do not give guarantees because they say it's not in line with the company's image. Second, it could be too many uncontrollable external variables. So let's take, in terms of hotel. In hotel, there are certain things in terms of service. It could be that it is controlled by the hotel, like the food is cooked warm and served to the customer. That is, hotel can control it, right? It will ensure it has a proper gas supply, electricity is running, and if there is a backup also, the power backup is also there. Air conditioning is running, hotel can control. Clean dishes, hotel can control. But what something hotel cannot control is that if the food has so many pesticide and insecticide and fertilizer into it, then the hotel cannot control the amount of pesticide, fertilizer, insecticide residue in that. Means hotel can control that the vegetables and fruits have been washed and served to you. Hotel can control the taste, but cannot control the chemical additives which have been added by the farmers. It's beyond their control. So they may not be able to offer, they can offer a guarantee on taste, but not on the amount of pesticide residue, the amount of insecticide residue. So in case you fall ill because of these things, then hotel cannot guarantee you for that. He can guarantee you for food hygiene. He can guarantee you that when the food is being prepared, it is being prepared in hygienic conditions. It is clear, there are no mosquitoes, there are no flies over there. That it can guarantee. Because the other things is something they are dependent on farmers, and they cannot control what farmers are doing. Unless, of course, the hotel says that we offer organic food. So fears of cheating by customers, that is also there. Many times they may not, guarantee, companies may not guarantee because they may think that customers may cheat upon them by putting false claims, right? Last is that the cost of guaranteeing may be too high. If something goes wrong, then the customer may put up a false claim, which may be very high. Service guarantees. So service guarantees work for companies who are already customer focused. Effective guarantees can be big deals. They put the company at risk in the eyes of the customer. Yes. Customers should be involved in the design of the service guarantees. Yes. Whenever service guarantee is being designed, the company should involve the customers directly or indirectly. Indirectly could be through a feedback, through understanding the customer response, you know, by observing the behavior of the customer. But directly could be through some feedback, by asking the customer, through some research study. The guarantee should be so stunning that it comes as a surprise, a wow factor. You know, it should be so good that, you know, the customer finds it so good that he'll purchase it from you again and again. So it's the icing on the cake, not the cake. This is a very good statement over here. The guarantee is an icing on the cake, not the cake. The cake is the service itself. So, right. So the icing on the, it should be like an icing on the cake. So aligning strategy, service and standards. So we have all gone through this, you know, new service development process. You business strategy development or review. So what you do is, there's a new service strategy development. You have the front end planning and the implementation. In front end, you have the business strategy review, what the existing one. Or if you have a new service strategy development, you create a new one. In the new one, you have the idea generation. We all know that, we have all studied. Concept development and evaluation. So in the idea generation, you screen ideas against new service. You concept development evaluation, you test the concept with customers and employees. Business analysis, test for profitability and feasibility. Service development and testing, conduct service prototype test. Right, market testing, you test, market test the service and marketing mix elements. You commercialize it, and post introduction evaluation. So the up to the business analysis is the front end planning. In the implementation, starts with service development, testing, market testing and commercialization, and post introduction. So here stop means that if there's a problem over here, stop and re-go over there. So you need to stop at different places, right? So this is how a new service development process. Just we had, you had already studied in marketing management about new product development process. This is very similar to that. The new service development process is similar, slightly different, but more or less is the same. So this talks about how a new service can be developed. New service strategy metrics for identifying growth opportunities. So over here you have the offerings, existing services and new services. Over here you have the, on the right hand top, you have the markets, current customers, new customers. So if you're offering existing services to current customers, you share the building. These are different names they have given, right? Then if you have new services to current customers, you service development. It's called service development. If the existing markets are to new customers, it's called market development. If new services are given to new customers, it is called diversification. So market development, product development, diversification, product promotion, we have all studied. So this service development is product development, right? So it's it could be like, you know, you're giving the same thing to the same service. So let's take this thing. You know, we are giving you, we are conducting classes for you in MBA, right? Through this. So it's sharing the building. It's the same thing. That doesn't, if your class are being conducted from first year, you are in second year. So it's the, you are at this place. But suppose we start some training program for certain, you know, we open, we have another program. Sunstone has another program. But, you know, if someone wants, he can avail of that services from Sunstone. So you are already a current customer, but we are offering a new service. That becomes service development. Over here, suppose, you know, in this case, market development could be that when new session, when new batch of students who have, who will be joining us next year, for our existing MBA program at Sunstone, it will be market development. So new customers, existing service. New services, new customers. It could be we are offering a different program which we are not offering to our existing customers, which is you, but a new product. Maybe, so let's take this. We are opening a course on, you know, engineering. So engineering undergraduate, right? So we will be offering those who are past 12th. So these are new customers. And it's a new service. So it will be called diversification. I hope you have understood this. service mapping or blueprinting. It's a tool for simultaneously depicting the service process, the points of service contact, and the evidence of service from the customer's point of view. So if you see over here, service mapping is basically, it's a tool or it's a blueprint which says that the what are the various processes involved in the service, various points of contact during the service, and the evidence the service has taken place at different places. It is from the customer's point of view, not from you, not from your point of view. You means the employee, right? So service blueprint components, one is customer actions, where all the line of interaction, on stage contact employee actions, where the employee makes an contact, his line of visibility. Then you have backstage contact employee actions, line of internal interaction. So this is on stage which the customer sees. This is backstage which customer does not see, but this is also happening behind it, and the support process. So just go through this. It's a service mapping for a company which is into express mail delivery service. Just go through this and see over here. You have the support process over here. You have the contact person. One is backstage, one is on stage, then the customer physical evidence. So these are the four different parameters, four different ways in which has been divided, as we have discussed here. Customer action, on stage, backstage, and support process. Again, process, points of contact, evidence. So just see this for a moment. Okay, okay, so can you explain what you have seen, Mansi? You are there. Mansi. Sorry, Manas. Manas, can you tell me what you have seen over here?
Yes, sir.
Huh, just tell me, what do you see?
Sir, express mail delivery service. There is various type of tape. Starting from truck packaging, prompts, then
no
customer
start. See, where will it start? The first mail delivery service, it will start from here. Customer calls. So when customer calls,
okay,
the customer physical evidence, right? He's calling. So this call will go to the backstage customer service order. He'll give the order, right? So this is the contact person at backstage, not in the front stage. And then the support process, there'll be someone who's behind him, who's part of the support process. He will dispatch the driver, right? Then okay, the contact person on stage means, on stage means someone who is contacting the customer directly in person. Backstage means someone who is contacting the customer, not directly, but indirectly through some technology, like in this case, telephone, web, and other things, chatting and all these things, right? So here it's on stage. Driver picks up the package from the customer. So he's on stage with the customer, right? In person. Customer gives the package.
Okay.
Customer gives the package, right? So all these things are done. Then the driver receives and loads to the airport. And this thing does fly to the sort center, flight this, there's a loading, fly to destination, then he unloads and sort, so, and load on truck. So all these things are happening at support process. Then again the package is delivered to the customer. So the driver delivers the package to the customer. He's again on stage contact person, and the customer receives it, right? So these are the, okay, if you see, support process, contact person, on stage, backstage, and customer, physical evidence. So physical evidence has there, na? Customer calls, physical evidence. Customer gives package, physical evidence. Customer receives package, physical evidence. So if you see,
yes,
if you see, this is what we are talking about. Like customer actions, line of interaction, right? This is the line of interaction. This is the line of interaction. These are the line of, this is the interaction between customer and this. This is the interaction. This is the interaction with customer. This is the interaction. So these are all the line of interactions, right? On stage, backstage. On stage, customer is seeing the company's driver. He's seeing driver, delivery boy and driver. But customer is not seeing the customer service operator or the, right? And the support process, he does not see. So therefore, this is backstage and this is support. And of course, you have the, the support process. So you have the process, you have the points of contact and evidence. So you have the entire process happening. This is the process, right? Then you have the evidence, all this thing, and then you have the, all this thing is evidence, and this is the point of contact. Customer is contacting him, customer is contacting him, customer is contacting him. Okay.
Okay.
So now see, just another example of your hotel visit. So whenever anyone visits a hotel, if you see the physical evidence over here, you see, see all these three, physical evidence. What is the physical evidence in a hotel? Hotel exterior, lobby, employees, key. All these things are there. Elevator, corridor, room, bellboy, bellhop, all these things are physical evidence. The, what is the stage over here? The stage is customer actions. What is the stage in customer actions? He makes reservation. Okay? Once he makes a reservation, then this is the line of interaction. After he makes the reservation, line of interaction starts. He contacts either face to face or he calls on the phone. So the person records and confirms. Up to here is the line of visibility. Customer does not see what is happening over here. All these things customer does not see. Customer sees only between these two, between this line and this line, customer sees. So that guy, that the hotel boy is entering the data. Then customer arrives. He gives the car to valet parking. Then doorman greets him. He takes the car again. He arrives on his own. That's a customer action. Then the doorman greets him. So interaction is taking place now over here, right? Now after he gives the car, the valet parks the car. So he does not see where is he parking the car. That's the valet are doing it. But the car has been taken. So it is beyond his visibility. So his interaction is over here. Then customer goes and checks in at the reception. Receptionist verifies, gives the key to the room. Again, it is front. Then he registers the guest data. Then he checks into the room, goes to the room and makes up a room. So room gets make up after he leaves or when he's going out, the new bed sheet support. It is happening without his knowledge, but it's being done in his absence. So all these things. So these are called the backstage. This visibility, below this visibility is backstage. Above this visibility is the front stage over here. And this is the physical evidence. Okay. Okay. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Clear, sir.
Now, building a service blueprint. How do you build a service blueprint? So this is a service blueprint which we discussed about. So how do you build one? You have to identify the process to be blueprint. So there's a process we discussed about the hotel visit. How we first you have to make a call, reserve your book, reserve your hotel booking. Then you go there, drop your car and so on, so and so forth. Identify the customer or the customer segment. map the process from the customer's point of view. So what we see over here is the mapping. Map means it shows you the ways by which the customer will go and do various actions. And it also tells you which action will come first and which will come second or third or last. Okay. Map contact employee actions on stage and back then. So these are the contact. All these things are contact, employee actions on stage, and these are employee actions backstage. So to map this, right? Link customer and contact person activities to needed support functions. So these are the support functions. You have to link it. So when the receptionist gives the key, then this is the link of registering the data. When the records are confirmed, when the customer makes a reservation and it is confirmed by the employee, this is front stage, but then the data is entered. So this is the, all these things are linkage. This, all the arrows what you see are linkage. This is dotted because this happens invisibly. Customer is not aware. This is dark because this happens in the with the customer's knowledge. Okay. Add evidence of service at each customer action step. So at each customer action step, there's an evidence. So here's an evidence. Make reservation, arrive valet park, check in at reception, go to room. These are the various evidences which are there, which happen. Okay. Okay. So this is how you build a service blueprint. So application of a service blueprints. New service development. You have to have a concept first, develop a concept, test the concept, ensure it is zero defects, means there is no problem with the culture of maintaining reliability and identifying issues. Then you need to have service recovery strategies in place, right? Identify what are the problems, what caused the problems, find the problems, and modify the processes as and when required. Blueprints can be used by service marketers. So they create realistic customer expectations, service design, systems design, operations management, who render services promised. So they ensure that the whatever fail points happen, they do not happen. They train the people how to prevent it, quality control and all these things. So blueprints can be used by service marketers, those who market the services, and those who implement the services by the operations people. By human resources, they ensure that they're hiring the right people for this various services what the company is giving, right? They give the right job description, they have the hiring the right people through right criteria, and accordingly they give proper appraisal to the employees based on their performance. Then system technology, providing necessary tools, system specifications, preferences, and all these things. So service culture. What do you mean by service culture? A culture where an appreciation for good service exists and where giving good service to internal as well as ultimate external customers is considered a natural way of life and one of the most important norms by everyone in the organization. So you have to create a service culture in the organization where you see your internal customers who are your employees as well as external customers. You try to fulfill their needs so that the company does well in fulfilling the needs of the final customers, which are the customers itself.
So, sir, yes. I have a doubt.
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, what do you mean by internal customer and external customer?
Internal customers are your employees. So when I'm hiring,
sir,
yes.
So the employee can be our internal customer.
Employees are internal customers because first of all you have to train the employees and they have to be empowered and they have to be given authority and they have to be trained nicely so that they can deliver the service nicely to the customers. If they don't deliver to the services to the customers nicely, then what will happen is the service, more service failure will occur. So that will lead to customer dissatisfaction and eventually lose. So your customers, when you say internal customers, the reason I'm saying internal customers, because when you are hiring the any people, you have to hire the right people and then you have to train them accordingly. You have to fulfill their needs of fulfilling their needs so that you have to give them a training in such a way where they understand. For example, in a hotel, five-star hotel, the training given to a general manager will be different than a training given to an executive because they're at different levels. But both their needs, both of their needs are to be fulfilled. So when you're designing a customer service mapping, you have to understand their individual needs and accordingly give them training accordingly. And of course, the appraisal system and all these things. So your internal, if internal customers are not satisfied, then they will, that is the employees, then they will not be, you know, happy to serve the external customers. So they're more likely to have service failures. So therefore, they are called internal customers. Correct?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Customer's role in service delivery. So importance of other customers in service delivery. Other customers can detract from dissatisfaction. Right? You know, too many people can come. You know, you can have customers who are not satisfied because, you know, their needs are not fulfilled. Their behaviors are disruptive. They can, but other customers can enhance satisfaction also. Just because they are present, just because of socialization, friendships, you know, they can give the, they can have a role like assistant teachers, supporters. So there are different ways, you know, other customers, they can detract from satisfaction of your existing customers, or other customers can enhance it. How customers widen gap? Lack of understanding of their roles, not being able to perform their roles, no rewards for good performance, right? Interfering with other customers, incompatible market segments. So customer roles in service delivery, just see this, right? Here, productive resources, you're giving it to them. Customers to quality and satisfaction, he's helping. Competitors. So these are the various customer roles in the service delivery. This is what the various roles performed by the customers in service delivery. Customers as productive resources. So partial employees. Because they are partial employees. Why? Because they contribute effort, time, or other resources to the production process. As we all know, the main thing about products and services is that the in services, the production and consumption happens at the same time. And because it involves so much of customization, right? So they help the company to ensure that the resources are used nicely to give satisfaction to them through the company resources. So they help the company in telling them what exactly they need, and the company customizes them, the process for them. Therefore, they are called partial employees. Customer inputs can affect organization productivity. Yes, the way the customer gives an input in a hotel, I want this type of dish to be prepared in this way, it can impact the productivity, because if he wants a particular type of dish which takes a lot of time, then probably that time is being used to serve him, and that kitchen area cannot, that portion of the, you know, that employee who's preparing for his dish is engaged with him. So probably when he takes a lot of time, he's probably cutting off the other customers who are waiting in line to be delivered their product. So it can impact the organization's productivity. So
right.
Key issue here is whether should the customer's role should be expanded or reduced. That's the question we need to ask. Customers as contributors to service quality and satisfaction. Customers can contribute to their own satisfaction with the service by performing their role effectively, by working with the service provider. The quality of the service they receive, how can they impact? By asking the right questions, by taking responsibility that they are satisfied or not, by complaining whenever service failure happens. See, even to complain is important, because if they don't complain, then the company will assume that the customer is happy, which may not be the case. So it is important the customer complains whenever service failure happens, so that the company can improve itself. Customers are competitors. Customers may compete with the service provider. Internal exchange versus external exchange. Internal external decision often based on expertise, resources, time, economic rewards, psychic. Psychic means based on psychology, right? Trust, control. So these are the various, they can be as competitors using the various, you know, internal external decision, which is often based on these things. Customers can compete with the service provider as well. Okay, strategies for enhancing customer participation. How to enhance customer participation? First of all, you define customer jobs properly, right? You Recruit, educate, and reward customers when you are promoting it. You recruit, educate, and reward the customers nicely, right? You manage the customer mix. So you have the, you know, various types of customers. You ensure you manage them nicely, right? And when all these things are put together, you have an effective customer participation. Managing demand and capacity. So you have to understand the demand patterns and capacity constraints, like capacity constraints, time, labor, equipment, facilities. You know, you have to use how much you can use and how much maximum you can use the capacity. The demand, you know, you have to understand the demand patterns. So you have to see when, at what times of the day, what time of the year is the maximum demand from the customer at what time. You have to decide the cycles. So we all know, like, you know, in times during summer, the sale of AC and fridge will be more. So the company will manufacture more of this, right? It will not manufacture so much of that in the winter season. So same as services, you see a hotel knows that during the winter season, customers are more likely to buy hot beverages like, you know, soups, like hot tea and coffee, rather than cold drinks, right? So they know that. So what they have is the hotel has a certain capacity, right? It has to match its capacity with the demand patterns of the customer base. So many things it understands because of, like, this thing we understand that people are more likely to buy soup and hot beverages, tea and coffee during winter than in summer. We understand that, but there could be many things, you know, which company does not understand. So probably through research work, it has to find out, right? So the company has to see, the hotel has to see that what is the best way he can use the capacity to ensure the demand patterns of the customer are fulfilled in the right time. Because if when summer comes, if he is not keeping adequate supply of soft drinks in his hotel, then the demand pattern is not being fulfilled. So that thing he has to see. And the demand pattern is by market segment. So you have to match the capacity constraints against the demand patterns in different phases of customers' life for different segments across different places and across different time zones and different times of the year. You have to see this thing. So for different customer segments, for different customer types, in different times, across different places, you have to analyze the demand patterns of those various customers and match them with the capacity constraints of your company, which is time, labor, and equipment and facilities. So here are, like, you know, some I've given: demand is too high or demand is too low. So use signage to communicate busy days, times, this. And so these are some of the things you can see what I just discussed. So, like, you know, take care of loyal or regular customers first when demand is too high. Advertise peak usage times and benefits of non-peak. So you look at this in Delhi. You have the metro service. There's a non-peak price, ticket price, and there's a peak price, peak travel ticket price. So non-peak, the metro is already saying if you travel between this time, you get a 10% discount. The idea is so that they can manage their capacity, which is the, you know, their staff, which is the equipment, is the metro, the stations and all these things, to maximize customer satisfaction. So customer also benefits. Customers already knows in advance that by coming maybe an hour later, he can save 10% of his ticket. And the customer and the metro also does not lose out the customer because they find it is too crowded, right? So this is when demand is too high. When demand is low, they use sales and advertising to increase business, modify service offering, offer discounts or price modifications, modify hours of operation, bring the service to the customer. All these things, they do it. Strategies for flexing capacity to match demand. So here it is, when the demand, just to shift the demand. Here it is to increase the capacity. flex it. So when demand is too high, stretch time, labor, facilities, and equipment. So an example for this would be when during certain festivals, or the, during certain festivals, Metro, Delhi Metro runs special services. Delhi Metro runs additional services. Even train during summer holidays runs additional services. The idea is that what you do is within the same time frame, you do something more because the demand is so much. So you have to flex, you have to make your capacity flexible. You have to flex your capacity, right? So cross train employees, train other employees to handle the high demand, hire part-time employees, request overtime from employees, share facilities with other companies, rent or share equipment, subcontract or may outsource the activities. Whenever the demand is too high, this is the other way you can also do if you don't want to lose your customer. If you want to intend to flex your capacity. If the demand is too low, perform maintenance renovations, schedule vacations, schedule employee training, lay off employees, means you get rid of the unnecessary employees. What is the nature of demand relative to supply? So extent of demand fluctuations over time. Extent to which supply is constrained, wide and narrow. Peak demand can usually be met without a major delay, like electricity, natural, this. Narrow. Peak demand can usually be met without major delay, insurance, legal services, banking, this. Peak demand regularly exceeds capacity. Accounting and tax, because everyone fulfills his tax during the month of March end. Right, month of April they fill it, so that time more people look for CAs and other things. Passenger transportation. So as I told you, during weekends the metro ridership is less, but weekdays it's more. During holidays, during special festivals, the metro ridership is high, right? So accordingly you have to, the more people want to go out. During the summer vacation, the more trains have to be run because so many people want to go and visit their friends, family for vacations. So passenger transportation, hotels and motels, right? Again, on weekends, there are more theaters. If you see, the weekend tickets are much more higher than the Tuesday. Same as restaurants, they're packed on weekends and their prices are higher. They give offer discounts on Tuesday or Wednesday on weekdays, so that they can have more people coming during the lean times. Right. Narrow. Narrow services similar to those in two over here, but which have insufficient capacity for their base level of business. So what we are seeing over here, different types of types of demand related to supply in different service industries. So these are some of the different industries which we have seen. Here it is white. For these type of industries, here it is narrow, number two, number four over here, these type of, so here you can see how the demand is wide for this one, where the peak demand regularly exceeds capacity. Here again it is wide, but peak demand can be usually met without a major delay. Telephone, no problem. Hospital, no problem. Electricity, no problem. Police, fire also can be met, but peak demand can be met without a major delay. It is narrow, very small. So, insurance, legal, इतना कुछ ये नहीं है कि मारामारी होता है, but इसमें थोड़ा हो जाता है. And over here, peak demand regularly exceeds capacity, and it is wide, cannot be met so easily. These are the services. And in number three are the same services in number two, but those who are having insufficient capacity for their base level of business. Okay, what is constraint on capacity? One constraint is time. So you see the type of service, legal, consulting, accounting, medical, there's a time constraint there. Labor, law firm, accounting firm, consulting firm, health clinic. Equipment, delivery service, telecommunication, utilities, health club. Facilities, hotels, restaurant, hospitals, this and this. So the type of constraint in particular service I have listed out over here. On the left hand side is the name of the constraint and right hand side is the type of service. Waiting line issues and strategies. So sometimes, you know, you have to wait along to get a get the customer satisfaction done. So you have the unoccupied. You what you have is what do you do in that case, right? So you have unoccupied team. You have to have a strategy to ensure that when a customer waits, so he does not get bored. He does not think it is too long. So certain things are done to ensure that he feels that he remains occupied and there is no unjust done. So if you see over here, whenever you call a call center or any service provider, and when they are asking you to wait for long, they keep on telling in the voice loop, keeps on happening that you are important to us. Please don't hang up. Our next available service operator will contact you shortly. You are important to us. And in between, some ads will be there. They'll tell you, give you some information. The idea is to keep you preoccupied so that you don't feel all of these things what are listed over here. So managing service promises. How do you manage a promise? A good service quality is directly related to the profits. A good service will lead to good behavioral intentions, which will lead to customer retention. When customer retention will reduce the cost, will increase the volume of purchases. Once he's satisfied, he's not sensitive to prices, so you can ask him premium prices. He will spread the word of good, he'll spread a word of mouth, positive word of mouth, which will lead to higher margins, which will lead to profits. And behavioral intentions also, you'll have sales and profits. So as you can see, ultimately a good service will provide good customer retention, and it will give you all these things and ultimately the profit. So 80-20 customer pyramid, many of you must have read in the marketing management, that it happens that according to this 80-20 rule, that 20% of the customers buy 80% of the products, or in this case 20% of the customers buy 80% of the services. So those 20% customers are very important to you. These are the best customers. So these are the customers you cannot afford to lose, because they give you a lot of business, right? So this is the segment where you have to spend more time. This is the segment which costs you less to maintain. You have the highest profit over here, right? Your goal should be to convert this segment, which is below, into this segment above. So other customers should become your best customers. So, in other words, least profitable customers should become most profitable customers. That does not mean you should ignore the rest of the 80% of the customers. It's just that you should strive towards making them the most profitable customers, and you should do much more for the more profitable customers so they do not become least profitable customers or they leave your company, just because they are also aware that they're giving so much business, so they want things in return. So you have again the expanded customer pyramid: lead, least profitable; iron, gold, platinum. We can all know that through these various names of various metals, that which is the most precious. Platinum is most precious, then next is the gold, then next is the iron, and lead is the cheapest. Therefore it is called as these are the most profitable are in the above, gold and platinum. Same thing explained in a different way. So service quality spells profits. Again, same thing: service quality, customer retention, cost, volume of purchase, price, premium, this thing, margins, profits, right? Offensive. So one is, this is defensive marketing. What is offensive marketing? Here the word of mouth will increase the market share, increase reputation, and more customers will be able to pay price premium, and therefore your sales will increase, so profits will come. This is from existing customers, defensive marketing, and this is from new customers, offensive marketing. So there's a link over here through word of mouth where the market share can also increase, besides the company's own offensive marketing. Improved margins and improved sales will give you more profits. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So, positioning services in competitive markets. So, you have to search for competitive advantage in service and therefore which requires differentiation and focus. So, you have to intensify competition in service sector, threatens firms with no distinctive advantage. Basically, your idea is you have to ensure that to get competitive advantage in the service industry, every service provider needs to provide a differentiation among of their service with the other service providers that they can do by providing, by remaining focused on fulfilling the needs of their customers. So this is what it means, right? And once you are able to focus on your customers and provide a different type of service, a differentiation in service to the other customers, therefore you have a competitive advantage in relation to your competitors. Four basic strategies for services. On the one hand, you have the breadth of service offerings. On the other hand, you have the number of services served. Right. So in breadth of service offerings, we have narrow and wide. Number of markets served, many and few. So here is narrow and many. You have service focused, breadth of services narrow, and number of markets served are many. So your services focused, right? Your breadth of service offerings is many and number of markets served are few. Fully focused service and market focused. Here you have breadth of service offerings are wide and number of markets served are many. So unfocused, you know, you've got everything for everyone. So over here you have breadth of service offerings few, service offerings wide, and number of markets served few. So market focused. So ideally you should be in these three. Ideally you should be in service focused, market focused, and fully focused. These three segments, it should be in these three. Only when there is less competition or you are offering extremely unique services, then you can go into this. But most of the companies would like to go in this, in these three. This one, service focused, market focused, and fully focused. Four principles of positioning strategy. First of all, establish position of a firm or product in minds of customers. So you have to understand the positioning. What do you understand by positioning? Positioning means they're finding a place in the minds of your customers in relation to other customers. Positioning means creating a place for your product and company in the minds of the customer with relation to the in their minds. Create an image of your company and product in the minds of your customers against your competitors. So to establish a position should be distinctive. It should be distinct, providing one simple, consistent message. So distinctive means the customer should be in a position to discriminate between your product, service, and the competitor. Very apart from the competitors, because if they are very close, Then the customers can find the switching cost between one your company, your product to other their. So it should be apart. So they should see the difference. Right? And also the customer company should be focused. Company cannot sell all the products to all the people all the time, right? So you have to understand it should be focused. Uses of positioning in marketing management. You understand the relationships between products and services. You identify market opportunities and make marketing mix decisions to respond to competition. So when you are your positioning, whenever you do the positioning, these are three things the benefits of it is. You understand relationship between products and services. So there you have to compare your product to competition or specific attributes. evaluate product's ability to meet customer needs, predict demand at specific prices, performance levels. Then next is you identify market opportunities to introduce new products, redesign existing products, eliminate non-performing products. Third is you make marketing mix decisions and respond to competition. Here you have a distribution service delivery. Here you have pricing and communication. So all these things. Possible dimensions of developing positioning strategies. So what are the various ways, dimensions through which you can develop positioning strategies? One is through product attributes. Other one is through relationship between price and quality. So means there has to be something. The price should match with the quality. If you're asking a premium price, then your quality should also be premium. Because unless if the quality is premium, then the customer will say, I'm not getting much value of my price. So what company customer will think, the price is so much, but the quality is not much. So he will not see any value. For the price paid, the customer should get the right quality so that he sees a value over there. Reference to competitors. The customer, the company, whenever the positioning is happening, there should be some reference to competitors. So, the companies promote their products saying that what things good they have, which the competitors do not have, directly or indirectly. They can tell them the usage occasions, on which occasions they can use their products. They can tell them characteristics of the user, right? That whosoever is using this is of that. So anyone who uses, like for example, if you're using a particular legal service which specializes in company law, in company matters, right, corporate matters, you can tell them, you'll tell them that we only take cases which are related to civil cases, which are related to company issues, not related to individual cases. So these are the user characteristics, you can say. And you can also say that, top companies, the top 50 companies in India are our clients of my legal service. So this is the user characteristics. So anyone who will come over there, they'll start associating their company with them. Then product class, all these things. What class of product is this? So developing a market positioning strategy. So whenever you're developing market positioning strategy, you first do a market analysis where you see the size, composition, location, trends, define, analyze market segments. Then you do internal analysis. You select market, you have resources, reputation, constraint, values. Through that you select market segments. Right, you select the benefits, then you have competitive analysis of their strength, weaknesses, current positioning, analyze possibilities for differentiation. Right, you bring all these things together and articulate, decide a position for yourself in the market, and then you create a marketing action plan. So, for developing market positioning strategy, you have to do marketing, market analysis, internal analysis, and competitive analysis. Branding service products. So service differentiation. The differentiation of service can happen through our offer, through the way it's delivered, through an image and service quality. So distinctive service offerings, like, hotel, Marriott hotels, Marriott hotel brands, they have Marriott hotel brands is the big umbrella brand within which it has multiple types of different brands, and it has created different brands among itself. Like you have resorts, Marriott resorts are offering different facilities than Marriott hotels. So accordingly, their offer, their delivery, image, service quality will be different. So like this, vacation clubs are different, their residences are different. So these are the offerings they are offering. A family of like Taj hotels. So Taj hotels is the umbrella brand, right? Of Tata is the umbrella brand. Then product line brand, you have the Taj, Vivanta, Gateway, Ginger. Now Taj is an expensive one. Gateway is where in the you have the resorts, and Ginger you have the rooms which are available for 3,000 to 4,000 rupees. It's two star hotel of Taj. So each one has different benefits. So the company tries to sell each one different benefits, offers, different delivery, different image, different service quality in each one of these different sub brands, so that a customer who goes to Ginger understands what type of facilities he'll get over there, at what type of rooms he'll get, at what price, what discounts will be available, and which places it will be there, right? So at different sub brands will have different support service levels. So here you can see the four Taj brands against rivals international brands in India. Taj, this Marriott, this, right? Vivanta, this. So Taj is one, it is in competition with this one. Vivanta is in competition with this one. Gateway is in this one, right? Ginger is in this one. So these are the international brands, and this is the Taj, various brands of Taj, and how they're competing with different. Top 10 brands in India. If you see the brand value, top 10 brands, SDFC 9.4, brand value is highest. So every brand can be converted into some value. So that's $9.4 billion in 2014. Airtel 8.2, SBI 6.8, ICICI, Idea, Reliance. You see the Reliance. People don't seem to trust the Reliance so much. So brand value is less. It is based on the customer service. Core and complementary services in a hotel, luxury hotel. So you can see, this is the core service. A bed for the night in an elegant private room with a bathroom. These are the supplementary services. Reservation, valet parking, reception, baggage service, cocktail bar, restaurant, hotels, telephone, wake up call, room service, business center, cashier. So these are all the complementary service. You have to ensure there is not much. The problem is that you do not have much competition in the core service. Everyone provides this. The real competition comes in the supplementary services. You can discriminate, you can distinguish your product, your service, and your company through these complementary services. What happens when and in what segment? So the time dimension in augmented service, you can see over there. Time frame of an overnight stay of hotel is just like a service mapping, right? You park the car, you check in, you use the room, use the porter, have a meal, Paytm, right? Use guest room overnight, room service, check out, get out car, right? So reservation, pre-visit to reservation. So these things, it's just a what happens when and in what sequence. So this is the sequence. And then this is how it goes out. So time frame. Time starts here and ends over here. Elements of your hotel offering. So these are various things you can study. Delivery options, alternative food service, you know, delivery options. Alternative meal service offering. Fast food service. You see the sign, park and enter, order meal and pay. Pick up meal, find table and eat, clear the table. Drive-in restaurant, see the sign, stop car at or order at order point, order via microphone, get meal at pickup and pay. Drive away and eat later. Home delivery, you telephone the restaurant, order the food, give address, driver rings doorbell, pay the driver, take the food and eat. You home catering, arrange to meet caterer, plan meal and pay deposit, food and staff arrive, meal is prepared and served, eat, staff cleans up and pay. So as you can see, the delivery options of a food service industry has different formats. And this is what the different formats, they have a different, you know, similar to this. What happens when in what sequence? So what happens when in what sequence? In one different, delivery options for different type of food industry in terms of different service industry in fast food, drive-in restaurant, home delivery and home catering. That's it. So any questions? Any questions?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. So thank you. That's the end of our course in service marketing. And I hope you must have enjoyed whatever I've tried to teach you, and you must have understood. If not, you have my email over there. You can ask me questions. There's no issue with it, right? And for assignments and all, I hope the assignment must be given to you, must be given to you regularly by the Ashish. And hope you must be giving to them back also. And probably you might be having midterm. You might have had it. I'm not sure. And your end term, whenever it is. Fine. Okay. We'll close
the session
for today. And thank you and good luck. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye.